would like to get into the final installment of our education series. And we pray that you will be able to make a decision, if you haven't, for true education. So before I begin, I'd like to request that we seek the Lord in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for the blessings of the Sabbath that reminds us that you are our God and our Creator and our Redeemer. Lord, as we look at your plan for us and how we have been lost, we pray, Lord, that we retrace our steps and seek you and seek your plan for restoring us to your image. Pray all this in Jesus' name.
To commit their lives in service to God.
So I hope we get it very clear so that we don't leave here troubled that you want to serve the world using true education. You can't. You cannot participate in the economic systems of this world with true education. Because remember, every path that you take as a destination, okay? If you take the path going to Homabe and you are on that road, you must go left or right. Is it left or right?
Right.
You must take right. Because you're going where?
Homabe.
Homabe. It doesn't matter how good or bad the road is, but you must take a right if you want to go to Homabe. So I want us to be very clear. Look at the destination of your path. If the destination is to work as a manager in East Africa Industries, please go ahead. Because there is a requirement. There is a preparation they expect you to have for you to be admitted as a manager in where? In East Africa Industries. If you want to work at the Coca-Cola group of companies, they have minimum requirements for you to enter them. And please go ahead and prepare or whatever they need you to qualify. Jesus Christ told his disciples when somebody came asking for them to pay tax, he said, look at the coin. Whose picture does it have? It was whose? Caesar. So he said, give unto Caesar that which belongs to who? To Caesar. So if you want to give service to Caesar, please meet the requirements of Caesar. We are not here to change the requirements for Caesar. No. The requirements for Caesar have not changed. And so if you want to give service to Caesar, give unto him that which belongs to who? To Caesar. If you want to work in a government office, there is a minimum requirement. I think it's a Form 4, isn't it? Very, very prison, right? If you want to work in some bank, they need maybe a graduate certificate, isn't it? So if that is your desire, please, this is not for you. So I want us to be very clear. We want to give unto God that which belongs to who? To God. So that we don't have mixed issues here. Because I see some people are troubled also now. What am I going to do? How will I do this? I have this plan to be a medical doctor. To be a medical doctor in this country, there is a requirement, isn't it?
Yes.
You must do a course in what?
Medicine.
In medicine. So you picture yourself in an office with those stethoscopes and a white coat, and you want to do this, please, you must go to university and do a course in what?
Medicine.
In medicine. Are we clear?
Yes.
Yes, we have to make a choice in this life. Do you want to dedicate your life in unselfish service, ministry like Christ gave us in Matthew 28, or do you want to spend your time in meeting with the requirements of this world? So there are two things we are discussing, and the requirements of this one are adequate for you to work in the positions of this world offers, and you cannot serve God and what? So we want to look at what is higher education. If it is your desire, if it is your desire to serve God exclusively as a missionary, if it is your desire to go ye and teach all nations these truths of the gospel, if that be your honest desire, and that's why you've been here, then this is for you. But if it's not your desire, then do not be worried about these things, because they do not concern you. Jesus Christ said, my kingdom is not
of this world.
Is not of this world. And we don't condemn the kingdom of this world. No. The kingdom of this world suits the people of this world. It has been designed specially for them. And it is perfect. As a matter of fact, when God describes Babylon, he describes her as delicate, as the best. God was surprised how good Babylon was. When you look at Jeremiah 51 or something, God described Babylon. As far as the purposes of Babylon are concerned, Babylon is fine.
but not as far as the purposes of who?
Of God.
So let's not mix issues here. You cannot be wavering between two opinions. If Baal is God, worship him. And if the God of Israel is God, do what? Worship him. So I just want to make that disclaimer so that we do not live here confused. What is your destination in life? What do you want to do in life? Where do you want to spend your time? Is it in the systems of this world? Or is it in honest and exclusive mission work? If it is mission work, then you must pay attention. But if it is not mission work, then this should not bother you. Are we together? Unless we understand the science of education, we will not have a share. Where? So let's go with those kind of clarification in mind. I would like us then to look at, if this be your desire, to have true education so that you can serve the master in the probationary time that is remaining, for we know not how long our life will be, then how does that reflect with the current education that we have been through? After all, some of us have spent our life in it, and others are in the middle and the thick of it. How does the current education affect us? What does God think about it? And where did it come from? And how? What was its purpose? So that we can understand how we should relate to it as we want to serve the Lord. This is the purpose of my presentation now. This is my last presentation. Just to clarify completely, what does God understand as higher education in terms of his service? Give unto Caesar that which belongs to who?
Caesar.
To Caesar. And give unto God that which belongs to God. And so, again, I'll take us, let us read together from the words of inspiration. By a misconception of the true nature and object of education, many have been led into serious and even fatal errors. Such a mistake is made when the regulation of the heart or the establishment of principles is neglected in the effort to secure intellectual culture, or when eternal interests are overlooked in the eager desire for what? For temporal advantage. Okay? To make the possession of worldly honor or riches our ruling motive is unworthy of one who has been redeemed by what? So we're talking about those people who have been redeemed by the blood of Christ. The ones who say, Jesus Christ is my Savior. The ones who claim the name of Christ. The ones whose names are being examined in the investigative judgment in the courts of heaven since 1844. Those people who are waiting in the most holy place by faith are the ones who are being addressed in the words in bread. Okay? To make the possession of worldly honor or riches our ruling motive is unworthy of one who has been redeemed by what? By the blood of Christ. It should rather be our aim to gain knowledge and wisdom that we may become better Christians and be prepared for what? Greater usefulness, rendering more faithful service to our Creator, and by our example and influence, leading others to glorify God. Here is something real, something tangible, not only words but deeds, not only the affections of the heart, but the service of the life. Did you see that? The service of the life must be devoted to who? To our Maker. We are talking about people who have been redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Remember on the Day of Atonement, it was not the whole world that stood outside the sanctuary. Was it? It was only who? Only the Israelites. Right? And when Jesus Christ hung on the cross of Calvary, not everybody would accept that sacrifice. And so those who have been redeemed by that blood of sacrifice are the ones who are being addressed.
bring man into harmony with God, so to elevate and ennoble his moral nature, that it may again reflect the image of the Creator. It's the great purpose of all the education and discipline of life. That is the great purpose of all the education and discipline of life. So important was this work that the Savior left the courts of heaven and came in person to this earth, that he might teach men how to obtain a fitness for the higher life. And we saw earlier on that even angels would not have been adequate to come and do the work. Jesus Christ left his busy schedule because this was important for him. And so he came himself so that there is no mistake about the kind of life that we who have been redeemed by his blood should live. And so he came to set that example. Okay? For 30 years, he dwelt as a man among men, passed through the experiences of human life as a child, a youth, a man. He endured the severest trials that he might present a what?
A living illustration
of the truths he taught. So the life of Christ is a living illustration that we can follow. The character of Christ is the one perfect pattern which we have copied. Repentance and faith, the surrender of the will, the consecration of the affections to God are the means appointed for the accomplishment of this work. To obtain a knowledge of this divinely ordained plan should be our first study. To comply with its requirements, our first effort. Every faculty, every attribute with which the Creator has endowed the children of men is to be employed for his glory. And in this employment is found its purest, holiest, happiest exercise. And so those children who consider themselves children of God, who want to glorify God, this is the kind of life that they should be good for. Okay? The true education is what? That's why I've taken a few minutes to just clarify. True education is you are being prepared to be a missionary. Missionary training. If true education is missionary training, then you need a different kind of preparation. You can't have missionary, you cannot be a missionary by being prepared to work for Caesar. Can you? No, because the preparation is different. Caesar has different requirements, just like Nebuchadnezzar has different requirements, right? And so, if you want to work for the king of the universe, he has a different academic requirement. We must not confuse issues that you can bring your certificate from Caesar and tell God, I want to be employed in your service. He will not take that. And so if your job, if your aim is to serve the king of the universe, then you must submit to his preparation. Moses did that, Abraham did it, Jacob did it, and all the patriarchs, they went through that academic training. And God has not changed. Every son and daughter of who? That's why I clarified at the beginning. If you are a son, and the daughter of God is called to be a what? Missionary. And so when you're talking about your children, what will my children do? Where will they go? This can only happen when you are confused about the destination. If you would like your children's destination to be the affairs of this world, the jobs and the positions and the vocations of this world, please do not begin here. You will live to regret it. Because they will not meet the entrance requirements to Babylon. They won't meet the entrance requirements for Caesar's palace. You must take them through Caesar's education. Then they can be able to participate in this world's economic system. But if you would like your children to be missionaries and to be fitted in the service of God, then you must subject them to through true education.
And Christ was able to make that distinction. He has to Caesar, that which belongs to who? To Caesar. So you must always look at their destination. What is the objective? What would I like my children to be? If my children would like, I would like them to be missionaries, put them through a curriculum for missionary training. If I would like them to be successful and to be self-independent and to have good jobs in this world and have drive cars and own businesses and stuff and participate in the banks and the corporations of this world, then please make sure you follow the requirements that Caesar has set in place. Have we got that distinction? We are not criticizing anyone, and we are not saying that that system is bad. That system is perfect for the system, for the things of this world. But you cannot take that system and use it for the service of who? Of God. We must make a difference between the holy and the common. Have we clarified this issue? So that we don't get things confused and say that we want to offer God strange fire. Do not offer to God strange fire. Okay? This object should ever be kept in view by Christian parents and teachers. And we see, this object, the object is the end result, the end purpose of the path that you're taking should ever be kept in view. We know not in what line our children may serve. They may spend their lives in the circle of their home. They may engage in the common vocations or go as teachers of gospel to eat and lunch. But all alike are called to be missionaries for God, ministers of mercy to the world. The children and youth with their fresh talent, energy and courage, their quick susceptibilities are loved of God, and He desires to bring them into harmony with divine agencies. They are to obtain an education that will help them to stand by the side of Christ in what?
Selfish
service. There is a great deal of talk concerning higher education, and many suppose that this higher education consists wholly in an education in science and literature, but this is not all. The highest education includes the knowledge of the Word of God, and is comprehended in the words of Christ, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. Our prophet is talking to our teachers in the schools of the Seventh-day Adventists that have been set up, that they were trying to introduce the things of this world as that comprising of higher education. And the prophet is warning them that there is more to it than just science and literature. We must get this very clear. We are not saying that the people of the University of Nairobi do not have higher education. No. This message was not meant for the University of Nairobi. It was meant for College of Medical Evangelists, the Loma Linda, the Andrews, and that. Those were the church schools that were purporting to prepare missionaries. And we are getting this counsel that it is more than just science and literature. They were trying to bring the things of the world and offering them as an offering to God. Alright? Okay. The highest class of education is that which will give such knowledge and discipline as will lead to the best development of character and will fit the soul for that life which does what?
Measures
with the life of God. If it is your desire to have the life that measures with the life of God, then you must have this knowledge and discipline that will lead to the best development of life. So let's look at the objective in view. Where are we heading? And so what do we need to get there? Eternity is not to be lost out of our record. Highest education will be that which will teach our children and youth, our teachers and educators, the science of Christianity. That will give them an experimental knowledge of God's ways and impart to them the lessons which Christ gave to his disciples of the paternal character of God.
When the word of God is laid aside for books that lead away from God and that confuse the understanding regarding the principles of the kingdom of heaven, the education even is a perversion of the name. I want us to stop there. When the word of God is done what? Laid aside. It means that you had the word of God previously. We cannot address this to a non-Christian. Because he has not laid away the word of God. He doesn't have it in the first place, isn't it? We are talking about the remnant, the present true believers. When you put the word of God aside, and then you go for the books that lead away from God and confuse the understanding regarding the principles of heaven, the education given is a perversion of the name. Unless the student has pure mental food, thoroughly winnowed from the so-called higher education, which is mingled with infidel sentiments, he cannot truly know God. Only those who cooperate with heaven in the plan of salvation can know what true education in its simplicity means. Those who seek the education that the world esteems so high. Are you seeing the two systems? There is an education which the world esteems so highly because it works very well for the world. Okay? And also those who seek for that education are gradual. Now, you cannot be led further and further from the principles of truth unless you have been there before. Are we together? Yes, if you have been baptized, you have been shown this is the word of God, and then you seek for that education that leads you further and further from the principles of truth. What do you become? You become an educated worldling. You have simply gone to the other system, which is perfect for that world. But you are going there as you are professing to march to where? To Zion. And that is where the confusion comes. At what price have they gained their education? They have parted with the Holy Spirit of God. They have chosen to accept that what the world calls knowledge in the place of the truths which God has committed to men through his ministers, apostles, and prophets. It is my prayer that you understand this. This is the most important. Remember, any education from kindergarten has one thing in view. University. All the curriculum from primary school, from secondary school, is all geared to give you an entrance to where? University. It is university that dictates the curriculum for the lower school. So this is that very fundamental thing that we must understand. Because a tremendous pressure will come to you. What about university? People will accept everything you tell them about true education, but then they will always have this question, what about university? And so unless you have a proper understanding of this issue, many fall on this one. We must be clear, what is our objective? What do you want to do in life? If your desire is to do the things of this world, then you must get into this world system. But if it is your desire to give your life and reserve it as a missionary, then you cannot be that missionary by this world. And you will see that reason, the reason why, in a short way. Now, they say they are parted with the Holy Spirit, they have chosen what to accept, what the world calls knowledge in the place of truths, which God has committed to men through his ministers, apostles, and prophets. The true higher education is that imparted by him with whom his wisdom, whose mouth cometh knowledge and understanding. In a knowledge of God, all true knowledge and real development have their source. Whenever we turn in mental, the physical, or the spiritual realm, in whatever we behold, apart from the light of sin, this knowledge is revealed. Whatever line of investigation we pursue, with a sincere pride, with a sincere purpose to arrive at the truth, we are brought in touch with the unseen, mighty intelligence
and is working in and through us. The mind of man is brought into communion with the mind of God. The infinite is the finite with the infinite. The effect of such a communion of body and mind and soul is beyond estimate. And in the history, in the Bible, the great leaders of the world have been brought into this reality that the children of God have a wisdom higher than theirs. Nebuchadnezzar saw that. Pharaoh, he saw that when he was perplexed with the dream of the seven cows and the seven wheat sheaves. He was shown that his magicians and astrologers could not interpret for him the dream. God has always excelled among those faithful, and the world has come to admit in Ezekiel with Joshua. Many examples have shown that we should be familiar with the one with whom his wisdom and what? And strength. Okay? In the teacher sent from God, all true education work finds its center. Of this work today, as very dear of the work he established 1800 years ago, the Savior speaks in the words, I am the first and the last and the living one. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. Okay? In the presence of such a teacher, with such opportunity for divine education, what was folly? Is it to seek an education apart from him? To seek to be wise apart from
wisdom?
Wisdom. To be true while rejecting
the
truth. To seek illumination apart from
light.
An existence without
light.
What a folly. That we who should know better, we who have come to an understanding of the truth, that we can actually seek an education apart from that teacher. To seek for wisdom when we know that this is wisdom. The fear of the Lord, that is
wisdom.
And to depart from evil is what?
Understanding.
Now, when we know that, how can we then go to seek for wisdom apart from the source of wisdom? How can we go to seek to be true where Jesus Christ said, I am the way, the truth, and the life? Okay? It would be perfectly safe for our youth to enter the colleges of our land if they were converted every day. But if they feel at liberty to be off guard, one day, that very day, Satan is ready with his snares, and they are overcome and led to walk in false paths. Paths, forbidden paths, paths that are not, that the Lord has not cast out. Now, shall professed Christians refuse to associate with the unconverted and seek to have no communion with them? No, they are to be with them in the world and not of the world, but not to partake of their ways, and not to be impressed by them, not to have a heart open to their customs and practices. Their associations are to be for the purpose of drawing what? Jesus Christ. The influence of error repeatedly presented. This was the danger of our early pioneers wishing to send the children who have been Adventist schools to the, when they were providing true education, in worldly universities. What happened? The attractions, here is the danger of our youth. The attractions in these institutions are such, and the teaching so intermixed with error and sophistry, that they cannot discern the poison of sentiment mingled with the useful and precious. I told you that there is some useful and precious stuff out there in the secular institutions. But you cannot discern the danger of what? The error that is so intermixed with truth. You cannot discern the poison of sentiment mingled with the useful and precious. There is such an undercurrent, and it works in such a manner that many do not perceive that it's constantly at work. Certain ideas are constantly advanced by the professors and repeated over and over, and at last the mind begins to assimilate and conform to these ideas. It is my prayer that you actually understand the danger that you will place yourself when you get to these places, and your commitment is to be a missionary. If you want to be a missionary, then this is a dangerous place. Because by the end, the mind will begin to assimilate and conform to those ideas. There is such an undercurrent. You will not see it on the surface. Everything looks useful. You can see the target ahead. I will get a degree. I'll get a doctorate. But there is an undercurrent. And even if you were the best chemistry student, even if you were the best doctor that will heal diseases, and we have learned how diseases should be healed, you will eventually assimilate those ideas. To many of our youth, there is great danger in listening to the discourses that are given by those who in the world are called who?
Great
men. Who are these great men? These discourses are often of a highly intellectual nature, and prevailing errors of science, falsely so-called, and of popular religious doctrine are mingled with wise sayings and observations. But they undermine what? The statements of the Bible, and give the impression that there is reason for questioning the truth of the inspired word. In this way, the seeds of skepticism are sown by great and professedly wise men. The seeds of what? The seeds of skepticism are sown in the mind. Okay? This is the kind of education who delights in. The enemy delights in this. When he can sow those seeds of skepticism in your mind, you are given some useful stuff, some very good facts of observation and some skills. But together with those skills, they sow seeds of skepticism. It is what? We learned yesterday about sorcery. By their sorcery. By her sorcery. Who was doing sorcery to the merchants of the world? Who was it? Revelation 18. Babylon, by her sorcery. This is sorcery. The great apostle inquired, who has bewitched you and has not obeyed the truth? Those who receive and admire the sentiments of these so-called great men are in safety?
Danger.
They are in what?
Danger.
They are in danger. For through the subtlety of the enemy, the sophistical reasoning of these false teachers takes root in the heart of our youth, and almost imperceptibly. What is the meaning of the word imperceptibly? It is very hard to notice something that is changing very slowly, that you can hardly notice that something has happened. Imperceptibly, they are converted from error to truth.
Truth
to error. I want us to understand the science of education. This is the science of education. But the conversion should be just the other way. Our young men who have seen the evidences of the verity of truth. Are you seeing who this is addressed to?
Yes.
It is addressed to the young men who have seen the evidences of the verity of truth.
Amen.
When you have those young men, you can't put them in a place where the enemy will sow the seeds of skepticism. Give unto Caesar that which belongs to Caesar. They should be firmly established and able to win souls to Christ from the darkness of hell. The purpose for our young men is to be firmly established and to be missionaries who can win souls to Christ. You cannot say you want to have that preparation in the schools of Babylon. You can't have that. Go there and be rich. Go there and work for Nebuchadnezzar. But don't go there to prepare for what?
Eternity.
to do the service of God. You can't go there to prepare for missionary work. He wrote that some university. This is great controversy, page 140, paragraph 5. Great controversy, page 140, paragraph 5. Let's say it. He wrote thus of the university, and then you are just quoting Martin Luther. I fear much that the universities will be found to be great gates leading down to hell unless they take diligent care to explain the Holy Scriptures and engrave them in the hearts of our youth. I advise
no one.
I advise
no one.
To place his child where the Holy Scriptures are not regarded as the rule of life. Every institution where the Word of God is not diligently studied must become
corrupt.
Martin Luther, Ellen G. White quoting him, is advising us never to place our children in the universities which do not hold the Word of God. He said, I am quoting. These are not my words. Do you have those books, Great Controversy?
Yes.
How many have them? Please go and turn to page 140, paragraph 5. Have you ever seen it? How many have seen this quotation? Ah, so we are together. So I think this is not so new. So he advised that the universities will be gates of hell for those who want to be missionaries for God. Every son and daughter of God is born to be a what? Now, I want us to just look back at history. This is history, and we understand this Martin Luther, when he wrote this statement, it was at the height of his reformation, when he was seeing the inroads of the enemy. The Jesuit system had mounted a counter-reformation, and Martin Luther was seeing that there was a danger in the reformation work that he had started. And so he wrote this, and I want us to understand the purpose and the origin of the current system of education. And so we will go back to historians. Now we are looking at the book Rulers of Evil. Okay, I'm sure I saw it being quoted here sometime early this week. Every ruled society has some form of Holy Scripture. The Holy Scriptures of Caesarian Rome were the prophecies and rituals, directions contained in the ten Sibylline Gospels and the Virgil's Aeneid. The Aeneid implied that every Roman's duty was to sacrifice his individuality as heroic. Annies had done to the greater glory of Rome and Pontifex Maximus. You guys have heard that title? Pontifex Maximus. Okay, we'll hear it later. The Sibylines, borrowing from Isaiah's much earlier prophecy of Jesus Christ, prophesied that when Caesar Augustus succeeded his uncle Julius as Pontifex Maximus, he would rule the world as Prince of Peace, Son of God, and Son of God. Augustus would issue in a new world order as he lived. This is a secular historian. Okay? The Sibylines and Aeneid were so beloved by the government priests that they were considered part of the Roman constitution. The same scriptures were made part of the United States Constitution when the mottos annuit coeptis and novus ordo seclorum, taken from the Aeneid and the Sibylines respectively, were incorporated by the Act of July 28, 1782. If you look at the American code, it has got that novus ordo seclorum. Okay? It is there, that motto. Alright? Now, the Sibylines and Aeneid were open only to priests and certain privileged persons. The people learned their sacred content by the trickle-down of priestly retelling. When the Old and New Testaments were adopted as the empire's official sacred writings, they too were given to the exclusive care of the priests. Okay? And in accord with the Roman tradition, the people learned sacred content from discretionary retelling. What does that mean? The priests decide what they should tell you that is in the scriptures and what they should not tell you. This had to be for the sake of the Holy Empire. For should the people acquire biblical knowledge, they would know that Pontifex Maximus was not a legitimate Christian entitlement. Knowing this, they would not empire could collapse. And so the monarchical Roman Church forcibly suppressed the Bible's intelligent reading. This is why the millennium between Constantine and Gutenberg is known as what?
The Dark Ages.
Sprinkled throughout the empire, however, were isolated Christian assemblies who had preserved scripture from the days of the early church. From them, the Bible invited an ongoing personal communion with the creator of the universe. They lived by the writings of which Rome was so jealous. By the 13th century, these assemblies had grown so vibrant that Pope Gregory IX declared unauthorized Bible study a heresy. He further decreed that it is the duty of every Catholic to persecute heretics. To manage the persecution, Gregory established the what? The Pontifical Inquisition. Over 50 million people were killed by the Inquisition. 50 million people. More than 50 million people died of that Inquisition. As quickly as our generation has become computer literate, the Gutenberg generation learns to read books, and careful readers found shocking discrepancies between the papacy's interpretation of God's word and the word itself. In 1485, the Archbishop of Mainz issued an edict banishing unauthorized Bible reading with excommunication, confiscation of books, and heavy fines. The great Renaissance theologian Desiderius Erasmus challenged the Archbishop by publishing in 1516 the first printed edition of the Greek New Testament. A Catholic monk named Martin Luther, against the advice of his superiors, plunged into the New Testament of Erasmus. He was shocked by the absence of scriptural authority for so many church traditions. The most explosive result of Luther's Bible reading was its attitude toward the papacy. Nowhere in scripture would the passionate monk find that God had ordained an imperious Roman vicar of Christ to rule over a vast economy based on the selling rights to do evil. These rights were called indulgences. They had been a church tradition since Pope Leo III had begun granting them in the year 800, payable in the money coined by Pope Adrian I in 780. So we are getting the history, where this thing is coming from, right? In 31st October 1517, Martin Luther formally protested the indulgence racket by nailing his famous 95 theses upon indulgences to the door of the castle church of Wittenberg. The church was said to own a lock of the Holy Virgin's hair, worth 2 million years of indulgence. Luther's thesis exhorted Christians to follow Christ, their head, through penalties, debts, and hell, rather than purchase a false assurance of peace from church indulgences. This is a history by a secular historian. Leo had Luther arrested and detained for 10 months in Wartburg Castle. While in custody, Luther managed to translate the Greek New Testament of Erasmus into German. Its publication alarmed the broadest reaches of Roman authorities. The history of the Reformation tells us that ignorant priests shuddered at the thought that every citizen, nay, every peasant, will now be able to dispute with them on the precepts of our Lord. Meanwhile, Leo X died. The new Pope Adrian VI hardly eulogized Leo when confessing to the Diet of Nuremberg that for many years abominable things had taken place in the chair of Peter, abuses in spiritual matters, transgressions of the commandments, so that everything here has been wickedly perverted. Adrian died shortly after speaking this line, to be succeeded by the cardinal who had been handling Martin Luther's case all along, another Medici, Leo's 10th first fascist. Giulio de Medici. Giulio took the papal name Clement VII. Luther and Melanchthon. Now, I wonder, we've looked at the history before the Martin Luther's Reformation, or just about that time, about the work of Martin Luther. Now, I want to look at the history from the view of Sutherland or Etienne, I'll have to confirm. Luther and Melanchthon, the great 16th century reformers, understood clearly that it was impossible to have a permanent religious reform without Christian education. These reformers realized that the strength of the papal church lay in its what?
Educational system.
I want us to be very careful here. This is where you must understand the problem and where we are today. They understood that the strength of the papal church lay in its educational system. And they struck a crushing blow at this system, and wounding it brought the papal church to her knees. The reformers established a system of Christian schools that made Protestants of the children. And so they saw that the way to deal with the papal system is to establish true education schools, not churches. Not going to build churches in the countryside. It is going there to conduct true education. Once the children have the right education, then they will deal with errors that were existing. The nobility of that country studied in Wittenberg. All the colleges of the land were filled with Protestants. Not more than the 30th part of the population remained Catholic. 20 years had elapsed in Vienna since a single student of the university had taken priest's orders. About this period, the teachers in Germany were all, almost without exception, Protestants. The whole body of the rising generation sat there at their feet and imbibed the hatred of the Pope with the first rudiments of man. From kindergarten all the way, they had a hatred of who? Education, not preaching, not camp meetings. It is education. After the death of Luther and Melanchthon, sadly, the theologians into whose hands the work of the Reformation fell, instead of multiplying Christian schools, became absorbed in the mere technicalities of theology. And passed by the greatest work of the age, they sold their birthright for a mess of potage. Satan took advantage of this blindness to cause some of their own educators, like wolves in sheep's clothing, to prey on the lambs. Some of their educators came in and pretended to be Protestants, but they were actually not Protestants. Just as Leo X's corruption had ignited Luther, Clement VII's shrewdness determined how the church will deal with the proliferation of what? Of true education? Were they trying to deal with true education? No. Their problem was the Bible. This is where we get these things from. The education system that we have today was designed to deal with your Bible. Clement was personally advised by the clergy Niccolo Machiavelli, inventor of modern political science, and Cardinal Thomas Wesley, Chancellor of England. Okay? Machiavelli and Wesley opined that both printing and Protestantism could be turned to Rome's advantage by employing movable type to produce a literature that would confuse, diminish, and ultimately marginalize what? Marginalize true education. No, they are not interested with your schools. You can have them all you want. What they wanted is to marginalize the Bible. The Bible has always been the target of the enemy. Cardinal Wolsey, who would later found Christ Church College at Oxford, characterized the project as what? To put learning against learning. Against the Bible's learning, we demonstrated how man could have eternal life by simply believing in the facts of Christ, death, and resurrection, would be put the learning of the Gnostics. Gnosticism held out the hope that man could achieve everlasting life by doing good works himself. To put it succinctly, Bible learning was Christ-centered, Gnostic learning was?
Man-centered.
Is it still man-centered today?
It is.
And that is the one we love so much. The titles, the opportunities it gives us, we still want to use it. Do we understand where this thing came from,
yeah,
the purpose of our education system today, the current education, I mean, just looking at it from a distance, when you see this whole mass of many universities and many schools and governments are so keen for their children to have the education, you must understand from whence did it come. It was the Catholic Church's plan to deal with the Bible. They had one simple objective. The Bible had been introduced to the common people, and so their plan was to produce a literature that would confuse, diminish, and ultimately marginalize the Bible. Has the current secular system of education achieved this end?
Yes.
And so you are sleeping with the enemy. When I told you that you wake up and find that you have a cobra on the bed, it is up to you to decide when you want to deal with it.
Yes.
And to know that this is not even an inspired writer. It's just a secular writer who was being chased by the government and said, let me find out what's going on with these people who rule us. And in even history, this is what is compiled. The stones are crying out. An enormous stroke, Medician. You know the Medician, the grandfather of that guy?
Yes.
An enormous stroke of Gnostic learning had been brought from the Eastern Mediterranean by agents of Clement VII's great-grandfather, Cosimo de' Medici. Suppressed since Emperor Justinian had piously shut down the pagan colleges of Athens back in 529. Remember when they decided the whole empire is going to be Christian, right? This celebrate when Justinian came to church, right? He decided to shut down those pagan colleges of Athens. Remember, Rome took over from where? From Greece. And Greece are the ones who had perfected education. Greece is known for their philosophers. All the philosophers you use, Plato, Socrates, Pythagoras, Solon, those who are Greek philosophers. And all of them had one thing in common. They went to complete their education where? In Egypt. And so Greece had such a brilliant work on education, in medicine, in science, in botany, in architecture. They were unsurpassed. They had perfected, just like Middle Persia were good in the things to do with the army and all that, Greece were known for education. And of course, the Roman Empire is known for its law. The law that is used today is Roman law. And so we need to understand those kingdoms that Babylon was shown, each one has contributed something to today's society. And so in the realm of education, the secular education that we have today is Greek education. And these are now those celebrated materials that had been hidden when Justinian came into church. This Clement VII's great-grandfather, he had collected those and put in his library. Okay? And so, his grandson brings these celebrated mystical, scientific, and philosophical scrolls and manuscripts that flattered humanity. They taught that human intelligence was competent to determine truth from falsehood without guidance or assistance from any god. Remember Paul's journey to Athens and how he debated with those Athenians, because Athenians like intellectual debates. They like to discuss the abstract. And Paul tried to convert, he couldn't even get one convert. Athens was known as a center of intellectual persons, alright? And so all that material now are being brought to deal with your Bible. Cosimo had stored huge quantities of this pagan material in his library in Florence. The architect was Michelangelo, welcomed scholars favored by the Pope. Okay. These scholars, not surprisingly, soon began emulating the papacy in focusing more upon humanity than upon the Old and the New Testament. So extensive was the Medici Library's philosophical influence that even scholars today consider it the cradle of Western civilization. Because the educational materials that is being used by the best universities that we have today is Greek medical. All the medical terminologies that you use in the School of Medicine are Greek words. All the words you will think about the herbs that they're using in the remedies, when you went with the original word, it is a Greek name. The Greek named every plant on earth. Martin Luther, seeing that learning against learning, he saw this coming. Seeing that learning against learning was the future of Christianity, voiced an appeal to the ruling classes. It's an article he wrote, in which he wrote rather poetically, and this is the one we find Ellen G. White quoting from. Though our children live in the midst of a Christian world, they faint and perish in misery because they lack the gospel in which we should be training and exercising them all the time. I advise no one to place his child where the scriptures do not reign paramount. Schools will become wide open gates of hell if they do not diligently engrave the holy scriptures on young hearts. Every institution where men are not increasingly occupied with the word of God must become corrupt. Through Christendom, this is great controversy. Through Christendom, now listen, these are the fellows, the architects of learning against learning. When Medici decided to introduce learning against learning, he needed people, a group, to execute that plan. This is what they did. Through Christendom, Protestantism was menaced by formidable foes. The first triumphs of the Reformation passed Rome summoned new forces hoping to accomplish its destruction. So Rome's objective was to destroy Reformation. At this time, the order of the Jesuits was created, the most cruel and scrupulous and powerful of all the champions of popery. Cut off from the earthly ties and human interests, dead to the claims of natural affection, reason and conscience, holy silence, they knew no rule, no tie, but that of their honor, and no duty to extend its power. And I tell you today, the Jesuit society is still the same. Their rules have not changed. Their purpose has not changed. This is their God. The gospel of Christ had enabled its adherents to meet danger and endure suffering, undismayed by cold, hunger, toil, and poverty, to uphold the banner of truth in the face of the rack, the dungeon, and the stake. Remember how the weak leaves and asked how they were burned on the stake. And the Jesuits looked at this and said, these people were brave. Even us, we must be like them. What did they say? To combat this force, Jesuitism inspired its followers with a fanaticism that enabled them to endure life dangers and to oppose to the power of truth all the weapons of deception. And the Protestants were fast asleep. There was no crime too great for them to commit. No deception too basic for them to practice. No disguise too difficult for them to assume. Vowed to perpetual poverty and humility, it was their studied aim to secure wealth and power, to be devoted to the overthrow of Protestantism and the reestablishment of the papal supremacy. Has Protestantism been destroyed? When did it come to an end? October when? Yes, they said the Protestants in this case, 500 years later. As they achieved their objective, what tool did they use? What tool did they use? Why are you not answering? What tool did the Jesuits use? It's because we are in that system. That's why we don't want to answer. What tool did the Jesuits use to kill Protestants? It is the education system. It is the degrees and the colleges and the courses that you are pursuing. Those are the things that brought Protestantism to an end. The order of Jesuits founded, now this is how you can identify that what you have been in the Jesuit system. They found its special mission in you know historian Painter? The historian Painter, you want to read history? You want to look for the book Painter. found its special mission in combating reformation. That is their special mission. As the most effective means of arresting the progress of Protestantism, it aimed at what? Peter was not an atheist. He has no enmity with Catholicism. He's just writing history. And he knows better than we that their best aim of arresting the progress of Protestantism, they aimed at controlling education. It developed an immense educational activity in Protestant countries and earned for its schools a great reputation. Harvard, Oxford, Cambridge. Many of us have prayed on our knees to go to those schools. More than any other agency, it stayed the progress of the Reformation. And it even succeeded in winning back territory already conquered by Protestants. It worked chiefly
through schools,
of which it established and controlled large numbers. Every member of the order became a competent and practical teacher. Education was their tool to arrest Protestants. And you have paid them money to do this work in the form of school fees. The Jesuit made much of emulation. He who knows how to excite emulation has found the most powerful auxiliary in his teaching. Nothing will be more honorable than to outstrip a fellow student, and nothing more dishonorable than to be outstripped. Prizes will be distributed to the best pupils with the greatest solemnity. Christ giving day, don't be happy. With the greatest solemnity. When during the graduation, doesn't the whole country come to a storm? With greatest people, don't they dress nicely? Don't all the grandmothers take vehicles from the upcountry to come and attend your graduation? Prizes will be distributed with the greatest solemnity. Here you see. It sought showing results with which to dazzle the world. A well-rounded development was nothing. Physical, mental, spiritual, that's nothing. The Jesuits did not aim at developing all the faculties of their pupils, but merely the perceptive, the receptive and reproductive faculties. Isn't that not what we do today? You read and reproduce in the exam, is it? When a student could make a brilliant display from the resources of a well-stored memory, he had reached the highest points to which the Jesuits sought to lead him. Originality and independence of mind, love of truth for its own sake, the power of reflecting and forming correct judgments, were not merely neglected. They were what?
Suppressed.
You try to ask your professor why you are saying that. Are you sure, sir? You will be doing the loop. You will be repeating that course many times. The area of reform as I conceive it. Now, this is the speech of one of the church leaders in 1953. He was making a speech in a general conference meeting. And this is what he said. How we lost our own true education schools. The area of reform, as I conceive it, goes so deep into our philosophy and practice as to point to complete revolution in our denominational policies of education. A revolution made necessary because we have previously devolved so far to the left that our backs are turned upon our pattern. My mind is so burdened with the state of our educational work that when I tell myself to keep silence and divorce myself from all sense of responsibility, I cannot rest or sleep. This is someone reflecting about how we lost our true education school, how we lost Loma Linda, Andrews University, Oakwood, Pacific College, and even Barrett. Yes. This is how we lost it. These writings of Ellen G. White constitute a blueprint which also our history shows has been little read, less understood, not at all comprehended. 25 years ago, in 1928, we came to our educational college in America. 1928, you know what happened that time? All the lower schools, all the secondary schools decided to accredit themselves with the secular system of education. They abandoned the church curriculum and decided to conform to the world system of education because they wanted their students, when they finished, to have the option of going to the secular universities. I told you that universities set the criteria for what will be taught in the lower classes. And so it started with our universities. The universities, Andrews, Loma Linda, Loma Linda accredited in 1922. Okay? Not quite sure when Andrews accredited, but it was much earlier, right? And so they decided to conform to the world system of education and offering the secular courses. And so as they continued, the lower schools looking up to our church schools, the lower schools were sending their students to our church universities. But now when they see the universities are conformed to the world, they also decided to conform to the world in the same way. And that happened in 1928. You know Kadesh Barnea, what happened to the Israelites? That is where they reached and they received the report of the spies. And they said, we can't make it, we can't deal with those giants. And that is how they lost the opportunity of going to the promised land. So when he says, we came to our educational Kadesh Barnea, and he told us, that's when we decided to go all out to the world education system. And that is why today you find in Baraton, they are offering the same course as we found in Jomo Kenyatta University or Nairobi University. That is why you find in our secondary schools, we are just offering the same school education system as what is out there in the world. There is no such thing as a charter school. It is just a name. But content, yeah, as much as the world. So this is what this writer is. He's saying he cannot sleep when he sees what happened in 1928. The promised land was before us, but the majority of our spies brought back an evil report. We voted for affiliation and accreditation with all that it involved of affinity with the world's education. It does not follow that taking heed to the testimonies would reduce our teaching bodies to the state of ignoramuses and imbeciles. And the men who were scorned because they had no degree were yet men of wisdom and ability. G.H. Bell, though he had no scholastic degree, was the one man who, in whose early times, who perceived the vision vouchsafed by the Lord with a school servant, Ellen G. White, and who sought with all his ingenuity and power to put the principles into operation. He was rejected as a leader in favor of a university-trained man, who later in life confessed to me that he had been, in his own words, an educated fool. G.H. Bell was the first teacher of the school that now became Andrews University. In fact, he's the one who taught the children of Ellen G. White and many of the church workers at that time. He didn't have a university degree, but he understood the principles of true education. And now as the school was becoming big, remember, the people who were working in the church, like you and me, had been educated in the world. And they still had a worldly mindset. And they were saying, why can't we have the leader of the school to be somebody who has a degree? And so there was a lot of pushing and pushing, and eventually he was pushed out, and they brought this educated fool. The closer affinity we met with the schools of the world, the farther we depart from the presence of what?
Of God.
To read the first articles and testimonies, volume 6 in the section Education, the need of education reform, is to feel a dagger struck into our educational policies. You can read that section. Right? Are we receiving the mark of the beast and his image of the sin of God? That's the question. We need now to begin over again. Reforms must be entered into with heart and soul and will. If there is not in some respect an education of an altogether different character from that which has been carried in some of our schools, we need not have gone to the expense of purchasing lands and erecting schools. This is the words of Ellen G. White. I was a student in Battle Creek at the time that that was written. I am a teacher now. My scholastic life spans the years, and I testify the need of reforms is greater now in 1953 than it was then. For we have what? Retrograded. Now, in 1953, they had retrograded. In 2018, how much more do we need an education reform? That is Elder A.W. Spalding to Bro Dixon, the Vice President of the General Conference. Thus says the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom, neither let the mighty man glory in his might. Let not the rich man glory in his riches. Let him that glory in his. He understandeth and knoweth. I am the Lord, with the exercise of loving kindness and temperance, and righteousness in the earth. For these things I delight, say the Lord. He hath showed thee, O man, what is good, what doth the Lord inquire of thee, but to do justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly in the earth. Who is a God unto thee, that pardoneth iniquity, and passeth by the transgression of the remnant of his heritage? He retaineth not his anger forever, because he delighted in mercy. Wash you, make you clean, put away the evil of your doing from mine eyes. Cease to do evil, learn to do well, seek judgment, relieve the oppressed, judge the fatherless, plead for the widow. Let us seek to follow the counsel of God in all things, for he is infinite in wisdom. Though we have come short of doing what we might have done for our youth and children in the past, let us now repent and redeem the time. The Lord says, though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool. If ye be willing and obedient, ye shall eat of the good of the land. But if ye refuse and rebel, ye shall be devoured with the sword. This will be our Herald, April 3, 1896, special testimony and invocation. As a church, as individuals, if we would stand clear in the judgment, we must make more liberal efforts for the training of our young people, that they may be better fitted for the various branches of the great work committed to our land. Are you seeing the distinction here? We want our young people to be fitted for the great work of highest order, that of Christ. That of Christ may not be hindered by the love of skillful laborers, who will do their work with earnestness and fidelity. It is right for the youth to feel that they must reap the highest development of their mental power. We will not restrict the education of which God has set no limits. But our attainments avail nothing if not put to use for the honor of God and the good of humanity. It is not well to crowd the mind with studies that require intense application, but that are not brought into use in practical life. Such education will be a loss to the student. For these studies, lesson is desire and inclination for the studies that will fit him for usefulness and enable him to fulfill his responsibilities. What do? The lesson is desire and inclination. And I have seen this in practice. I have seen that when you do this system of education, the secular education, the lesson you have desire to serve God. By the time you get the crown of the top, the hope, then you are completely killed any desire you have for your mission. A practical training is what far more than any amount of mere theories. It is not even enough to have knowledge. we must have ability to use the knowledge
aright.
The time, means, and study that so many expend for a comparatively useless education should be devoted to gaining an education that would make them practical men and women fitted to bear life responsibility. Such education would be of the highest value. I hope that you did not lose me. I am talking about sons and daughters of whom? Of God. You must go through an education that will fit you to be a missionary. And we have seen that the education system we find ourselves in was decided, it was designed to destroy what?
The Bible.
To destroy what?
The Bible.
The Bible. And so you have an education system here that is an avowed enemy of your God that you want to serve. We have been learning about worshipping the true God. Would you be an efficient soldier to fight God? Would you be fitted to be a soldier to fight the word of God? Why are you not answering? Would you be fitted and prepared to be a soldier to fight the word of God?
No.
It's a question you have to ask yourself. I didn't say it. The prophet said it. The historians, who are not even Christians, said it. They say that the Jesuits established schools and whose chief objective was to kill Protestants. The whole world was announced in, was it in 2016 or last year? In October 31st. That the protest has ended. They have succeeded. So the prophecy, Painter wrote this a long time back, and his writings have come to pass. That their work of the Jesuit schools have achieved their objective. And we are still in Babylon when we are being told, come out of her, my people. It is my prayer that our God is the God of mercy, and he still extends to us the provision time. Right? Let us abandon our sins. Let us come back to him. If it is that we want to be missionaries to God, let us give unto God that we belong to God. Let us seek the preparation that he has set for us, the blueprint which he has given us, that we can be fitted to be laborers and co-laborers with Christ. This is my prayer. I hope it is your prayer. If it is your prayer, let us seek the Lord. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you because you are loving, you are kind, you are merciful, not wishing that anyone should perish. Lord, we thank you because you saw us, you chose that you would entrust us with these truths. The greatest truths that were ever entrusted to mortals. The truth of the three angels' message, of your soon return, of your work in the most holy place, the sanctuary of God. And Lord, you sought that you should prepare us through a system of true education that will be fitted as missionaries for you, to serve you and to use all the talents that you've given us to your honor and to your service. Lord, you've seen how the enemy has blinded us and our parents and our great parents and the whole world to enter into the enemy of into the service of the enemy, to be prepared for an education that we thought would lead us to be of service to you, but was actually against you. And Lord, you are asking us, like you asked Saul, why are you fighting me? Why are you pricking against the wrong? Lord, I pray that we might obey like Saul, whose name was changed to Paul. And Lord, he decided to join the army. And Lord, he wrote half of the New Testament when he had obeyed you and he did dedicate all his life to you. I pray, Lord, that the army of workers that are here today, who are aspiring to be missionaries, will understand the blueprint you have for their training. And we can all engage in true education, both of ourselves and of our children, that we can be fitted for the missionary's will. This is my prayer, and I pray that this will be the prayer of those that are here. For we pray all this in Jesus' name.
Amen.